on with me as we go. As we retell the tale from of old. Though we were slaves to Pharaoh for so long, we Jews were not alone. As Moses told us, we go home. The Pharaoh who filled us with fear. The tenth way they keep dragging down. We ran down to the Red Sea and drowned. The Jews were not alone. The war is hard and we ran home. The commandments that Moses brought down, though we were lost, they helped us to feel found. We Jews were not alone. God brought us to Israel, our home.
Happy Passover and welcome to Temple Shalom Emeth's Second Seder. Every year on this night we say, why is this night different from all other nights? And this year we have to add, why is this year different from all other years? Behind me is an empty chair sitting at an empty table, symbolizing so many things about our lives at this moment. We are remembering the hostages who cannot be free to sit at a table. We think of those who died on October 7th, who will never be able to join a Seder again. We think of all those innocent civilians who we will never be able to befriend and invite to a Seder table. We also think about those parts of ourselves which are missing this year. Something about our happiness, our energy, our enthusiasm, our assumptions about life, all are missing this year as we try to internalize the trauma that we've been living under for the past 7 months. So as you enjoy our Temple Shalom Emeth Seder this evening, we hope that you will garner that spirit that's been missing for the past months and know that we need to be resilient in the face of all the horrors that we've faced, and that we can't let the anti-Semitism which has been rising in our country and around the world on college campuses and in our towns keep us from being true to ourselves as Jews, being able to fully enjoy our traditions and our customs, and truly being ourselves. So please enjoy Temple Shalom Emeth's Second Seder. Shalom.
Hello, everyone. Welcome.
Chag Pesach Sameach.
Chag Pesach Sameach.
Great to see all of you. This is one of our largest Seders ever. We are just absolutely thrilled and delighted to have all of you with us.
Please join us as we have to get out of that place.
Lighting of the candles. So, where's Robin? Why don't you come on up and light the candles for us? And why, all the children, come on up and stand with Robin. Emma, go over there. We'll say the blessing together, but it's not going to end with Shabbat. It's going to end with Yom Tov. Ready?
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kishanu b'mitzvotam, tzivanu v'hadlik ner shel Yom Tov. Praised are you, O God, whose presence fills the universe, who has sanctified our lives through your commandments and commanded us to kindle the lights of the festival.
And now we're going to sing the blessing, thanking God for enabling us to reach this special moment.
Ah, 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 ah
praised are you, O God, whose presence fills the universe, who has given us life and strength, enable us to reach this moment of joy. So we thank God for enabling us to reach this moment. We thank God for all of these children who now may go back to your seats. All right, you all should know this one. And just this one change on the first line, it shouldn't be Saturday, it should be Seder Day. Very important change.
Right. Here we go. It's 6 o'clock on Saturday, the Passover crowd is shuffling in. A Haggadah is sitting right next to me, reminds us of where we have been.
Cup of wine. How many cups of wine do we drink at a Seder? Who knows? Four. Why four? Anybody know why? If you know the answer, say it real loud. Nobody knows why four. Because there are four times that God promised that God would redeem us from the land of Egypt. And there are four letters in the Hebrew name of God. So we're going to start with the first cup of wine. So everybody pour a little wine or grape juice in your cups.
Thank you.
And we'll read together. The Hebrew word kiddush means sanctification. The wine is a symbol of the holiness of this moment. We share the sacred story and celebration with one another and with all the generations who have come before us and all who will come after us.
Are you saying?
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagafen. Amen.
L'chaim, you may drink your first cup of wine. And you may be seated. And so the next part of our Seder, part of our order, is washing. And I need all of the kids to stand up. All children, stand up, please, at your seats. Who here has not washed your hands recently? All right, I see some people bravely raising their hands. So we need all the children to go wash your hands in the bathroom. And we'll see who can do it the fastest and come back, because you're washing your hands on behalf of all of us. You just did? All right. Then Jared, you win the prize for having the cleanest hands. We're all waiting for you, so hurry up. Did they wash your hands as well? Allegedly? Okay, good. Did he use soap? Okay. All right, who can come on up and show us your hands? Come on up, show us your clean hands. It suddenly got much quieter in here, didn't it? Okay, hold up your hands to show everyone. Turn that way. All right, clean hands. We'll applaud for anything in this room. All right, why don't we have the Snyder table read next? Gotcha. I did that just so that you would leave. All right, Orchatz, 1, 2, 3, go.
Slaves eat quickly. They often have no opportunity to wash or time to reflect.
Tonight we are free.
We wash and we express our reverence for the blessings that are ours.
And thank you. And now we continue with the Karpas, the rebirth and renewal. Why don't we have the Tormund singer group lead that?
As spring reawakens all that is green, let us reawaken our bonds to the world of nature. We dip greens into salt water and acknowledge through our blessing that there is a creator and a purpose to the universe, that we are partners in the world of creation.
Okay, and this year in particular, we think of the salt water as symbolizing the tears that we have shed over the past year in particular, and that we are not all free, and we have great sadness. But the parsley shows us that we have renewed hope. So let's dip everybody should have parsley around somewhere on the table. And we're gonna dip it into the salt bowls of salt water, which should be on your table somewhere. But don't eat it yet, because we have to say the blessing. Hold it after you dip it into the salt water. Hold it up. All right, let's say the blessing together. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Borei Pri Ha'Adama. Praised are you, O God, whose presence fills the universe, who creates the fruit of the earth. And now you may dip your parsley into your mouth.
All right, and now we're going to continue with the next part of our Seder called the Yachatz, the breaking of the middle matzah. And our, before you, you see three complete unbroken pieces of gluten-free matzah. And they symbolize the perfection and the wholeness of the world. But as we all know, our world is very broken right now. So we take the middle matzah and we break it in half. And the broken half is called what? What is this part now, Aileen? The afikoman, excellent. And what does afikoman mean in Greek? Dessert. Okay, so I am going to take this afikoman bag, which Aaron made when he was about 5 years old. By the way, I forgot to introduce my son Aaron and my mother Bernice and Aaron and our friend Matt Siegel, who I've never met, who jumped in late, who was Aaron's professor in law school and worked with him at the ACLU. So anyway, so this is what Matt, this is what Aaron was doing when he was five. What do you think?
He submitted it with his application.
He submitted it with his application to the ACLU. I'm very proud. Oops. So I am going to put the middle part, the afikoman, in here, and later, actually, all the kids, there are lots of afikoman around, and you're all going to do what later with the afikoman?
Yeah!
You're going to find them, and then you're going to get a prize from me. So pay attention.
Do you want us to bring the middle matzah also?
No. All right, so this is the official afikoman right here. So now we're going to continue read at the very bottom of page 7. As we break the middle matzah, we think of all those in the world who feel broken or incomplete. We focus on those parts of ourselves which are in need of repair. The middle matzah is broken, but it is hidden inside the whole. We realize how the world around us may seem complete, but how much of it hidden from view needs our help. We hide the middle matzah and long for its recovery, our ability to feel whole, and our responsibility to help redeem the world. And then we continue, Alach ma'anya da'achalu avatanu ba'arab demitzrayim. Let all who are hungry come and eat. Let all who are in need come and celebrate Passover. Today we are here, next year in the land of Israel. Today we are slaves, next year we will be free. And we think really in particular of all those we know who are hungry right now, and our hearts are with them. But now we're going to continue as we introduce the four questions in our own unique way. Those of you who are around the Vietnam War era should know this one.
Well, it's 1, 2, 3. Why are we asking for? Don't ask me, I don't understand. Our friends is contraband. Whether earth, big place, and we climb right now. Well, it ain't no time, it's 1, 2, 1.
Whoopee! Okay, let's see. Let's have the head table again read the bottom of page 8.
Free people ask questions. We begin our Seder with questions. Although the custom is that the youngest at the table asks, tradition instructs that all must ask.
Okay, kids, this is your big moment. I need all the kids to come up. You're all going to chant the four questions together that I know you've been working on in religious school, right? Do you all know it by heart? You don't even need the book? Okay. And you can even turn around and face your parents and everybody. Need all the kids to come on up. And maybe the adults will even help you a little bit if that's necessary, but I don't think it will be. Thank you.
Okay. Look at Ben or your parents or everybody.
Manishtana Alayla Hazem Miko Alelo Shevako Alelo Amukmi Kamei Sumatsa Alayla Hazem Alayla Hazem Kulo Asa Alayla Hazem Alayla Hazem Kulo Hasa Shepherd Halino Anuofi Shehar Yirako Shehar Yirako Alayla Hazen Alayla Hazen Kulo Maror Alayla Hazen Alayla Hazen Kulo Bechol halelot en anu matinim afilu ba'am echad afilu ba'am echad alayla hazeh alayla hazeh shetehim be'amim alayla hazeh alayla hazeh shetehim be'amim Bechol halelot Anurmi ben yoshvinu ben misubi ben yoshvinu ben misubi alayla hazem alayla hazem kulan misubi alayla hazem alayla hazem kulan misubi.
Let's give them a huge round of applause. That was awesome, you guys. You can go back to your seats. Thank you so much. That was wonderful. And now we're gonna read it together in English. Why is this night different from all other nights? On all other nights, we eat either leavened or unleavened bread. Why on this night do we eat only matzah? On all other nights, we eat vegetables of all kinds. Why on this night must we eat bitter herbs? On all other nights, we do not dip vegetables even once. Why on this night do we dip greens into salt water and bitter herbs into sweet harosa? On all other nights, everyone sits up straight at the table. Why on this night do we recline and eat at leisure? And in good Jewish fashion, we ask all kinds of questions and we never answer them. We just keep asking them.
That's why we have to have it year after year.
That's right. So as we ponder the answer to all those questions, of course, we have a digression. And let's see. Let's have the Shabarella family and those sitting with you read a digression. Okay, so everybody who thinks they're a wise child, read the next paragraph.
What does it mean to go?
Okay, Steph, do it on behalf of all of us.
I'm sorry, there's a word missing here.
What?
The wise one asks, what is the meaning of the laws and traditions God has commanded? You should teach him or her all the traditions of Passover, even to the last detail.
Okay, everybody who considers themselves the wicked child, stand up so we can all see who you are. And read the next paragraph, please.
The wicked one asks, what does this ritual mean to you? By using the expression to you means to exclude ourselves from our people and divide the God. How did we get this way? Is arrogance and rebellion a form of slavery?
Thank you. I tend to not believe that you're the wicked one, Sue, but the simple one, the one who kind of doesn't really understand what's happening, but kind of observes things from afar. if you dare, stand at your seat and read the next paragraph. All right, so the simple one doesn't even want to say it, they just want to observe, so let's read it all together. The simple one asks, what is all this? Is the question a reflection of innocence and wonder, or indifference and apathy? Can one be an innocent bystander to poverty, war, slavery, or genocide? So all of those who don't even know enough how to ask the question, please rise. Shelly, it's always the wise ones who stand up for the ones who don't know enough to ask. Shelly, go ahead.
The one who does not know how to ask. We have all experienced being so confused, baffled, or overwhelmed with life that we couldn't figure out how to even ask a question. It is up to us to help those who are lost.
Thank you. And of course, the real answer is that all of us are the wise one, the wicked one, the simple one, or the one who does not even know enough to ask, depending on the situation. So we're really, all of us are all four. So we just have to think about what that means for our Jewish identity, being part of our Jewish community, or being part of the of world situations in general. So now we're going to continue with the Magi, the answers, even though these are the answers not to the questions that we asked before. So we'll continue on page 11. We were slaves in Egypt and God freed us. Together we celebrate not what we were or what our ancestors were, but what we have chosen to become. Out of persecution, we have discovered the meaning of our choice to live as witnesses to one God who calls upon us to mend the world. All right, Val and Jeff and you guys over there.
Torah recounts the early history of the Jewish people. God commanded Abraham to leave his country and his father's house and go to the land of Canaan, where he would become the founder of a great nation. Abraham and his wife Sarah obeyed God's command and journeyed to Canaan. Their son Isaac married Rebekah, their grandson Jacob went down to Egypt.
Together? Why did Jacob journey to Egypt? Because his beloved son Joseph had become prime minister to Pharaoh, king of Egypt. When a famine broke out in Canaan, Joseph asked his father and all his family to join him there. And Israel dwelt in the land of Goshen, and they were fruitful and multiplied. Okay, let's keep going down the table. Andy and Arlene and you guys over there, and Heidi. And Isabel and Peter.
Joseph died and all his brethren and all that generation. Now there arose a new Pharaoh over Egypt. He was not Joseph. And he said to his people, the Israelites are too many and too mighty for us. Let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply and come to pass as we get into the war and join our enemies to fight against us.
Thank you. And now we're going to continue with No One's Getting Past Old Pharaoh's Grasp to the tune of Creek Alley. Please join us.
Josh and DG were getting kind of itchy just to leave the Satan lifestyle behind. Paul and Danny working for a penny. After everything, they want to say, Menashe and Ephraim, we're having a bad time. In Egypt, you know where that's at. No one's getting past old Pharaoh's grasp.
Moses said to Pharaoh, you know, God will send along a plate to her king. Let us go. Pharaoh said to Moses, you know that this proposal won't get you far in June. Israelites are cold and wet, and after every torture, they were bereft. Menashe and Ephraim were having a hard time in Egypt, you know where that's at. And no one's getting past old Pharaoh's grasp. No one's getting past old Pharaoh's grasp.
And now we're going to digress from the digression and go back to the story on page 13. We read together. Pharaoh's cruelest decree was to drown every Israelite baby boy in the Nile River. Amram and Yocheved would not kill their newborn son. Instead, they hid him in their hut for 3 months. When his cries became too loud, Yocheved placed him in a basket on the river. Their daughter Miriam watched to see what would happen. Why don't we have the members of the Burlington School Committee and Lisa and Martha do the next one. Page 14, as Moses grew older, he could not ignore the suffering of the people. Once when he saw an Egyptian beating an Israelite slave, he could not control his anger and killed him. Knowing his life would be in danger, once the news of this deed spread, Moses fled to the land of Midian, where he became a shepherd. Why don't we have the Reinholm family back there to the next paragraph? God told Moses to return to Egypt to bring the message of freedom to the Israelites and to warn Pharaoh that God would bring plagues on the Egyptians if he did not let the slaves go. Moses was such a humble man that he could not imagine being God's messenger. I will be with you, God promised Moses. With this assurance and challenge, Moses set out for Egypt. His brother Aaron helped him. The Markle clan over there. Of wine because we cannot fully appreciate or experience the joys of the wine and our freedom unless we also think in our hearts about all of those who are injured or hurt or suffering. So by the way, is there anybody who here who can show us what a frog jumps like? Okay, Jared, come on up and you'll demonstrate the frog plague. Matthew, are you going to come up also? We happen to have a couple of frogs here. Yes. All right, everybody watch very carefully the frog plague. Go ahead.
Ready?
One morning his Pharaoh woke in his bed.
You know the whole song?
It's a real short song. Just enough for about three or four jumps.
One morning is very frog on head. Frog on his nose. Frog on his toes. Frog here. Frog there. Frog we're jumping everywhere.
All right. Thank you, Jared and Matthew. So now we are ready. Does everybody have some wine in your cup? You're going to need wine in your cup or grape juice. You're going to need wine in two things, wine in your cup, and you're going to need pinkies. All right, so when we say the name of the plague in Hebrew, you're going to dip your pinky into the wine. Last night I was told that some people use the bottom of their spoon, which to me is not much fun. All right, but what are the other, your bottom of your spoon or your pinky, you're gonna put it in the wine, and then when we say it in English, you're gonna put a little drop on your plate. Ready? Pinkies up. Dom. Blood. Sfardea. Frogs. Kinim. Lice. Arove. Beasts. Dever. Blight, Shaheen, Boils, Barad, Hail, Arbe, Locust, Hoshef, Darkness, Makat Bechorot, Death of the Firstborn. And so to appease ourselves, we put our pinkies in our mouths, the mouths that were newly washed by the children a short while ago. Okay, so we are now going to continue on page 16. We read together. Had God taken us out of Egypt without bringing judgment against them, Dayenu. Had God brought judgments against them without carrying us across the sea, Dayenu. Had God carried us across the sea without caring for us for 40 years, Dayenu. Had God cared for us for 40 years without giving us the Sabbath, Dayenu. Had God given us the Sabbath without the gift of Torah on Mount Sinai, Dayenu. Had God given us the Torah without bringing us into the land of Israel, Dayenu. How many gifts that God has granted us. And I also, well, as we sing this, I'm going to need everybody to come up who has two little pieces of paper that I gave them earlier beforehand. Caroline, Jen, Alicia, etc. Okay. And if anybody wants to come up and sing Dayenu with us, come on up. Or just come on up and dance. You can just do that too.
Nathan, 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 Nath
Breaking news analyst.
Good evening, Annie. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. My name is Wolf Spitzer of PNN, the Passover News Network. Breaking news. Pharaoh's trial is about to begin. I have just finished reading all the indictments, and I can tell you that the news is not good for Pharaoh. He was hoping to be found innocent of obstruction of justice. But this report clearly states that there was numerous occasions, 10 to be exact, when he obstructed God's command to allow the Israelites to go free. We don't know all the details, but we know enough from the biblical transport that he could easily be found guilty in the highest court of all, the Supreme Court, if you know what I mean. Wait, I'm getting word that the lead witness for the prosecution, Moses himself, is about to arrive at the shore of the Red Sea for a press conference. We now take you there live.
I'm in quite a rush. I didn't even have time for my bread to rise.
Or to put on his costume. Keep going.
I didn't even have time for my bread to rise before I left home this morning. I've got miles to go before I sleep. I've only got time for 4 questions.
Hi, I'm your sister Miriam from SFNBC, Sister Miriam Network Broadcast News. Is it true that God told you to take our brother Aaron with you as your legal counsel when you went to see Pharaoh? I'm the one who followed you down the Nile River, saved you when you were a baby, and made sure you were taken care of in Pharaoh's house. What's up with that?
That's a tough one, Miriam. I would have loved to have you help me win our freedom. Women, unfortunately, don't have so many rights yet. So no matter how brave and talented they are, I personally would have loved to have you help me win our freedom. Only God knows the answer to that one. I'll let you lead the women through the Red Sea with a timbrel in your hand. How's that? Next question.
Over here, your brother Aaron from Lox News. Wasn't it God who was obstructing justice by hardening Pharaoh's heart every darn time we went to the palace to ask him to let our people go? Shouldn't God be a co-defendant here? What's up with that?
I'll take that one, Moses. I am the Lord. Are you questioning my answers, Aaron? The consequences could be severe. If I were you, I would focus my investigation elsewhere and stop asking so many questions.
Okay, 2 more questions. Then my staff and I are hurrying off to an extended road trip overseas.
Yoo-hoo! Over here! It's your right to Bora! Can you please tell me why this investigation has taken up so much of your time? You asked Pharaoh once, you asked Pharaoh twice, you asked Pharaoh 10 times. It's bad enough we had to break our backs building those ridiculous pyramids. Do you have any idea what you're putting us all through? Bloody water, frogs, cattle disease, darkness. Now we're rushing to the sea. How do you expect us to get across there? No one knows how to swim.
Wait a minute. This press conference is supposed to be about Pharaoh being guilty of obstruction of justice, not me.
Wait 1 second.
I'm your mother, Yehoved, and I've got an important question, Mr. Big Shot. Why did you kill that Egyptian taskmaster? Didn't I raise you to use your words and not your fist? Don't you know it's a mortal sin to take another's life?
Mother, not now. Can't you stick to the topic and help me look good in front of the court of public opinion?
Just hold on there, Moses. I'm Middlesex District Attorney. I'm here from the future. I am just afraid that this line of questioning is not going to help convict Pharaoh. Do you have any hard evidence? Do you have even one frog? A vet bill for a deceased cow, perhaps? Any proof of hail? Perhaps a photo from a recent eclipse? Do you have a petri dish with some lice? A baggie with locusts? The evidence all seems very circumstantial. I can't go forward with this. The defense attorneys would tear us apart. The ACLU would be outraged. I can't imagine that Pharaoh is ever going to be convicted by a jury of his peers. He doesn't even have any peers.
Excuse me, what did you say your name was? Middlesex District Attorney Ryan? From the future? First of all, that was way more than four questions. I believe all of this is written in the transcript. Sorry, but I'm out of here. I've got a seat apart.
Well, there you have it. Moses himself commenting on his very own five books of Moses. Hold on. Breaking news. I'm receiving breaking news that the Red Sea has parted, and Moses is leading the Israelites to freedom. We'll keep you updated every 30 seconds for the next 48 hours. Now, back to our regularly scheduled Seder.
Thank you very much to our... Thank you so much to our not quite ready to for Passover players. Great job. And now we are going to continue on page 18. We read together, the experience of the Exodus made us a free people. No matter how oppressed we are, deep inside we remain free. We know that power cannot vanquish freedom. In each generation, every individual should feel as though he or she had actually been redeemed from Egypt. As the Torah teaches, you shall tell your children on that day, saying, it is because of what God did for me when I went free out of Egypt. For the Holy One redeemed not only our ancestors, God redeemed us with him. As it says, God brought us out of there so that God might bring us to the land of our ancestors. All right, and now we're going to read at the very bottom. You shall not wrong a stranger or oppress him, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. Now we'll continue on page 19 with Pesach. And I happen to have, who has a bone at your table? This is a very historic bone. It's I got it from Stop and Shop 10 years ago, and somebody told me 10 years ago, if you just put the bone in your freezer and save it to next year, you don't have to keep going back to Stop and Shop every year.
That was
so,
me.
That was you? Oh, that was God. So when the Great Temple of Jerusalem was still in existence, our ancestors ate a special sacrificial offering called the Pesach, or the Paschal Lamb. The word Pesach means to pass over. The offering was eaten as a symbol that God passed over the houses of the Israelites, as the Torah teaches. You shall say, this is the Pesach offering we offer to God because God passed over the houses of the Israelites when God destroyed the Egyptians, but our homes God saved. Everybody take a piece of matzah, conveniently located on your table. And you hold it up. We read together, why do we eat matzah? To remember that even before our ancestors' dough had time to rise, God saved them. As the Torah teaches, and they baked the dough which they had brought from Egypt into matzah. It did not rise since they hurried out of Egypt, and they could not delay, nor had they prepared other provisions for themselves. Now somebody hold up the bowl with horseradish at your table. We'll read together. Why do we eat bitter foods? To remember that the Egyptians embittered the lives of our ancestors with hard labor and mortar and brick, and in every manner of drudgery in the field, and worked them ruthlessly in all their labor. The bitter herbs must be chewed and tasted. It is not enough to talk abstractly about oppression, to analyze the causes which led to slavery, to read about the forced labor camps. To the best of our ability, we are to experience the lives embittered by oppression. To taste the bitter herbs is part of the process of feeling the affliction of body and spirit of enslaved people. Therefore, let us rejoice at the miracle of our liberation and thank God who brought us from slavery to freedom, from despair to joy, from mourning to celebration, from darkness to light, from enslavement to redemption. Oh, and look, now we're at our second cup of wine. So everybody, fill your cups again for our second cup. And rise at your table so we can say the blessing together in body or spirit.
Ready? Ready to join me?
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, Borei pri hagafen. Amen.
Well, Chaim, enjoy your second cup. And now, everybody may be seated unless you're female. Miriam saved the Jewish people through water. She followed her brother Moses as he traveled down the Nile River. She led the Israelite women in song and rejoicing after they crossed through the Red Sea. There is a midrash that God gave Miriam a well, which followed her as the Israelites journeyed through the desert. Both Miriam and the well were sources of sustenance, comfort, and healing. So now we have a special Miriam's cup, which even has a little picture of Miriam on it. We place Miriam's cup on our Seder table to honor the important role of Jewish women in our history and tradition. O God, you sustain us with water. May we, like the Israelites leaving Egypt, be guarded and nurtured and kept alive in our personal and communal journeys. May we use our powers of sustenance, nurturance, and healing, symbolized by Miriam and water, the source of life, to bring redemption to all we see as we travel together through the wilderness and time. This one's for all the females. Finally ready to eat.
And so we're going to everybody take a piece of matzah and hold it up, and we'll say the blessings over the matzah. Baruch atah Elohim Melech Haolam,
Hamotzi Lechem Min Haaretz. Amen.
And the blessing over the matzah, Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Asher Kishanu B'Mitzvotav, Tzivanu Al Achilat Matzah. Amen. And then you may take a little bite of your matzah. And now you can take a little bit of that maror, that purpley maror at your table, and put a little on your plate, and actually put it, you can put it right on your matzah, and we'll say the blessing together. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Asher Kishanu B'Mitzvotav V'Tzivanu Al Achilat Maror. You may have a little... Take a bite of your matzah and maror. And now we're going to take some charoset, which is also conveniently located on your table. Mindy Stanley made charoset for all of you. Thank you, Mindy. Mindy over there. So we're going to put a little charoset on top of the maror, on top of the matzah, and we're going to have a Hillel sandwich. To the sage Hillel, eating matzah, charoset, and maror together was not a trivial matter. To him, slavery and freedom were merged into one historical event. The bread of poverty became the bread of freedom and should be tasted together with the bitter maror and sweet charoset, so that one should know both the bitterness of slavery and the joy of freedom. In times of freedom, we must not forget the bitterness of slavery. In times of oppression, we must keep alive the hope of freedom. Enjoy your Hillel sandwich. Come back up in 1 minute to dance some more. But first we're going to drink some wine.
Yeah! She's got the right idea.
Yeah!
Ready?
Yeah! Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Borei Pri Hagafen.
You may be seated. We have completed the telling of our ancient story. Why do we tell this story year after year, generation after generation? Because it is the foundation of our hope and the basis of all Jewish dreams. After expulsion and inquisition, pogrom and Holocaust, what gives us this kind of strength? Only one thing, hope for the future. Because we saw the sea split, because we were free from slavery, we can dream. We know that God has purposes in human history. We know that power is not history's last word. We continue at the bottom. We give thanks for the land of Israel and its citizens, our brothers and sisters,
who have embraced the sick, the poor, the homeless, and the fragile from the four corners of the earth. We join with them in building the land and in the realization of our prophetic dreams for peace. L'shana haba'a b'Yerushalayim. Next year may we celebrate in a Jerusalem of peace. Next year may we celebrate in a world healed and free. And now I need all my dancers up here, because now we're concluding with our favorite song. Next year may we all be free, adults too. Ready?
Verily, Rabbi Lee is true. Up ahead of the bay, deep in the heart of the canyon, down Tennessee way. Oh, but there's shining above in Jerusalem. All the Jews are rejoicing in their freedom. We really hope to find next year everyone who is free.
Get up from there.
To find a liberty, we ask for good fortune for the poor and oppressed, and may God grant us peace and happiness. Oh, Jesus in Israel, we hope you know, from strength to strength, we hope you know.
Who's wrong? Better known as God on the keyboard.
God. Really hope that by next year, everyone will be free. From whatever end, finding liberty. We ask for good fortune for the poor and oppressed, and may God grant them peace and happiness. They're really rocking in the play, up a half a day. He's in the heart of Netanya, but I'm telling him, way. All over their shadows. In Jerusalem, all the Jews are rejoicing in their freedom. All the Jews are rejoicing in their freedom.
One more time, everybody.
All the Jews are rejoicing in their freedom.
Here from the rabbi who wrote all those great lyrics. Yay!
Thank you. And I wanted to thank Val Jacob and Mindy Stanley and Robin Frisch and Jeff Nussbaum and everybody else who helped put this entire Seder together. I said Mindy. And if you have leftovers, we need you to take them home with you. Thank you so much to everybody for making this meal and this evening so delicious in every way possible. So thank you all for coming. And if there's more food, keep eating.
Keep eating.
Happy Passover, everybody. God bless us.